Hi there, welcome to week two of field journaling. Today I'm planning to take you down to the river behind our house and do a little bit of my journaling down there so you can see my approach, at least to establishing the context. Before I do that, I'm going to go ahead and spray on some herbal tick repellent. We've had Lyme disease up here in Vermont for about 6 years now or so. It's interesting that it's only become more common in that amount of time. Some people suggest that that's a consequence of climate change. Of course, we've always had deer ticks around here, but not infected with Lyme disease until in the last few years. I actually just heard a report yesterday on the radio that as the coyote population is starting to replace the red fox population, that means we have a larger population of mice and therefore greater incidences of tick-borne diseases as well. So I do advise you, if you're in this part of the country, to put something on when you go out. We don't use DEET, although that's awfully effective. This stuff's been pretty good. It's called Green Mountain Tick Repellent. Product placement. Actually, I don't think you could get that anywhere outside of Vermont, but we've been pretty lucky. I actually heard somebody suggest that another pretty effective tick repellent is just mixing white vinegar, two parts white vinegar with one part water, and then including some essential oil to add some flavor. So there's a road crew at work behind me. I'm going to go ahead and head on down to the river. You'll see that we have quite a few ostrich ferns around here. I'm not very good at identifying ferns, but I'm getting better now at looking at the ostrich ferns, in part because this spring I wanted to show my son how to harvest fiddleheads, which of course are immature ostrich ferns. And I had to learn quite a bit about these ferns to do that, including the fact that they, as the fiddleheads unfurl, they are surrounded by sort of a brown papery substance. There's a deep groove running down the inside of the stem. And there's no fuzz on the stem either, which other ferns have. Of course, there are lots of other ways to identify ferns, but these are such a distinctive part of this little riverbank area that it's a plant I certainly need to get to know better. So this is the Pulteney River, just below the falls, and we've got a few acres here along the river. It's undergone a lot of changes over the few years that we've lived here, especially due to Tropical Storm Irene. There used to be an island out here about maybe 50 yards long with trees 30, 40 years old on it that was dug out, amazing process, and has left us a swimming hole. A little bit of the island still remains up here. We're down here at the downstream tip of what used to be that long forested island. And as you can see, it is now being taken over by Japanese knotweed. Now this is something that I'm trying to figure out how to deal with as an invasive that will just dominate that island. And I've been keeping it off the shore as much as possible. Don't want to use any poison, of course, because it's in the river. So what I'm doing this year, I'm following a suggestion of somebody who's had some luck with this. And they say if you keep cutting it down as it grows up for about 3 years,
it will eventually die out. So I need to get out there again probably tomorrow, cut it down. I just take a scythe out there and knock it on down. We'll see if that works. It's something that's not easily extirpated, but I'd sure like to get it out of here.
All right, so down here we've got a brief moment of sunlight between some showers this morning, so I'm going to take an opportunity to show you the kind of context that I would provide in setting up a day's journaling. One of the things I often ask students for is more context. So some of it is pretty basic, obviously the date and the time. It's basically noon, a little past noon right here. We're down at what we call Rocky Beach. It's our main beach down below the house here. We also have a sandy beach downriver. And then the weather. And the weather is usually what I'm looking for more context. So at the most basic level, it's overcast. And as I mentioned, between showers. Probably about 65 degrees, not too hot today. It's somewhat humid. I'm going to put here, and I'll then check that out on a computer when I get back up to the house, figure out what the humidity is today. I'm imagining it's probably in the 80s, 80% humidity, something like that. The clouds throughout the day have been primarily stratus clouds, but they're giving over to cumulus now. Stratus to cumulus. Remember that Claire offers a way to actually sketch them, something like this, where you actually make a frame for the clouds, and then we're getting the layered parts of the stratus cloud and some puffy parts for the cumulus. Not a great drawing, but that's okay. We're just recording details here. Let's see, what else do I want to include over here? Stratus to cumulus. The fact that I mentioned between showers is important. Up until about a half an hour ago, it hadn't rained since early this morning. And there would have been no real reason to mention this, except for the fact that there are lots of things out right now that are out because it did rain this morning. I expect if we went up to Howe Hill across the road, we would see plenty of red efts out right now. They come out after a rain. But if that hadn't been listed, I might not have noticed them. Let me see. What else do I want to get here really quickly? Breeze. No breeze to speak of. The clouds do seem to be moving to the southeast. So there are these beautiful pink flowers growing up around here along the shore of the river, and I'm going to try a blind contour of this and see what I can accomplish there. If nothing else, it ought to be good for a laugh and helping ease any anxiety that you might have about your own artistic ability. All right, so again, I'm looking at the flowers and not at my page. Now I'm not lifting the pen. I'm getting the four petals as best as I can. I'm going to have to go back later and give a sense of the colors. It will hopefully enable me to look them up a little more. Got I'm seeing underneath the flowers that there is a whitish substance here. This blind contour is obviously not going to be very useful, but I'm going to come back down at another time. Let's see, I guess we can come up like this. I'm sort of cutting myself out of room. Here we go. Okay, pretty pathetic, but what I know is that they're a deep pink. The stalk in this case is about 3 feet long. It's got lancet leaves that come out of the stalk in twos. White in the center. And even below that white, there is a yellow. And look at here. I don't know if the camera catches this, but we've even got a caterpillar here that I could also sketch if I wanted to. So that gives me something to work from. But again, just a very basic blind contour, the whole point of which is simply to get our hand-eye coordination a little better so that we're practicing that. I will come back and I will... it's starting to rain, as you probably can see here, so I'll come back down in a little bit and try to sketch it well enough to actually identify it. In my experience, a scientist tends to take their journal into the field with a very specific task in mind, and so the perceptions that they record are going to be much narrower in most cases, where a naturalist may not know at all what they're going to journal about until they see something that catches their interest. There are advantages to both approaches, and I want you to chart your own course somewhere along that spectrum. I will say this, there are things that would fit perfectly well into a naturalist's field journal that would not belong in a scientist's field journal. Some of those things can actually be very interesting. As we begin to talk more about phenomenology and to think about the relationship of the perceiver to the object that is perceived, I think it's useful to begin at least to speculate about the way that our moods, that our physical well-being has to do with the way we observe things. I'm pretty convinced that, for example, if we suffer from allergies, that's going to determine the length of time we're willing to be patient observing something. It's probably going to determine where we go. It may determine which plants we try to stay far away from. And it may just keep us indoors. That's pertinent information. No need to go into great detail. Likewise, if you're carrying something heavy with you, I think you're probably going to observe things differently than if you're feeling buoyant. But we'll talk about that in a future discussion. Thanks so much.